The first question is, what is Lp(a)? It's a large sticky protein made by the liver and found in blood plasma. It's a variation of the protein that forms LDL. It consists of an LDL-like particle, ApoB, but again, like I said before, it's got this little patch of Velcro. It's called, each of these is a Kringle repeat. And as I said before, there are a couple of mechanisms. One is that this Kringle repeat makes it sticky. Another is that this, something about this part of the protein actually makes, triggers clot formation. Any comments about your own story specific to these two issues, Chuck?
No, not really. Nothing specific.
So, as you mentioned, most docs don't know this. And you asked me what portion of docs, and your estimate was like 5%. I would think that's a generous estimate. I mean, even among primary care docs who need to be the folks that are aware of things, may not know how to treat everything, but at least can find stuff and can triage it to the correct place. I don't think even 5%. That means 1 out of 20.
Probably right more now. Like cardiology. As far as cardiologists, yeah. It might be more like 5%.
I think you're right. Now, that would be my guess. It's probably closer to 1 out of 20 among the cardiology community. And you know the rest of the story on this too. And it's like, well, we don't know anything that we can do to fix it. So just tell them to do everything else and we won't even look. That's why most primary care docs, I mean, even more primary care docs, are just not aware of, and patients aren't aware of it. Let's talk for a minute about some of the risks. So significant elevation gives you 2 to 4 times the increased risk for cardiovascular disease. You talked about a range. So most people have a range 5 to 29 in a milligrams per deciliter, and that's 13 to 73 nanomoles per liter. Now, the risk, depending on what level of risk you're talking about, starts at 30 milligrams per deciliter or 75 nanomoles per liter. And it starts rising much more steeply when you get about just a little bit less than double that, 50 milligrams per deciliter and 125 nanomoles per liter. Now, let's go back with those numbers in front of us, and you tell us a little bit more about your numbers. I think you were saying you got up to a couple of hundred nanomoles. Is that correct?
Yeah, my level was 243 nanomoles, and you mentioned that it's also measured in milligrams per deciliter. It's really important to understand what you're looking at, and a lot of people, even doctors I've talked to, a lot of them will get this wrong. It's amazing. It's unfortunate that there's not a uniform, you know, measurement used. The conversion factor is approximately 2.5 to 1, so yep. It's not an exact figure. It varies person by person, but if you take your milligrams per deciliter number, multiply it by 2.5, that would give you an approximation of your nanomoles per liter. And, you know, go backwards. If you're in nanomoles, you could go backwards to look at your milligrams per deciliter by dividing by 2.5, which is important if you're looking at research and trying to understand, you know, if they're talking about milligrams per deciliter and you've got a measurement for yourself that you're looking at nanomoles per liter, you might want to do that little conversion to understand relatively where you're at. But yeah, so again, 243 at baseline, and that was on a statin. So basically, there's a slide. This shows, this was a study published in 2007 by Dr. Samikas and Florian Cronenberg and several others, and it showed many things. One of the things they looked at was Framingham risk factors graphed against Lp(a) tertiles, and really interesting finding to me. This was one of the studies I came across early on in my research. If you can control your Framingham risk factors, which are, you know, your weight, your BMI, your blood pressure, your LDL level, whether you smoke or not, whether you have obesity or not, or whether you have diabetes or not, and if you control those, and if you can get, you know, all of what this graph and what this study suggests, that if you achieve near optimal level for your Framingham risk factors, even if you have elevated Lp(a), you can bring your hazard ratio or your risk, you know, pretty close to the normal population. Might be a little different for someone like me. This is top tertile. So you're talking about people at 23 milligrams per deciliter and up. I'm 4 times that. That might not be enough to just control the Framingham risk factors for somebody like me that's up in the top 5 percentile. But what it suggests to me is that my gosh, and this is why I think it's so important for everybody to know. Dr. Brewer, you mentioned that a lot of doctors will have this attitude, well, there's nothing you can do about it, so why measure it? Why test for it? This is a great reason why. If you know that you have something, if you have an Lp(a) is an independent risk factor. It's been fully established, settled science that it is an independent risk factor. If you know that you have something that might give you 3 or 4 times risk of a normal person, that might be something that would be highly motivating for somebody to lose that extra 25 pounds or 15 pounds. Because there are things that you can do, you know, for most people that have elevated Lp(a), there probably are things you can do in terms of lifestyle or maybe therapeutics that could bring your risk. You know, again, this is based on, you know, what the studies seem to suggest. You could probably bring your risk, let's just say you could bring your risk down substantially, you know, and possibly close to that of a normal person. So what I did, I decided that I was gonna, you know, lose 25 pounds to try to get to BMI. My target BMI was 24, and I was able to achieve that. I had sort of borderline hypertension. My high end of my blood pressure, I was about 135 over 90. So wonderful thing about losing weight is it just hits so many of the Framingham risk factors. I'm now in the target for the BMI. My blood pressure, when I lost the weight, my blood pressure came down. I'm now 115 over 75. My blood pressure, so that's optimal.
So I'd like to talk with you a minute about the webinar. People don't understand what the webinar is. It's actually a great way to get some access to healthcare that you're just not going to get any other way. You actually get the lab tests yourself at a local lab, a Quest lab near you, for the inflammation panel and the OGTT and the insulin survey. These are things, inflammation and prediabetes, that your doctor just does not know about. And here's the thing. Harvard Health and many others have said, look, sudden death is not always so sudden. The Hollywood picture that it's a bolt out of the blue is not realistic. It's more like real lightning, preceded by clouds, wind, and rain. Stop that metabolic storm before the lightning strikes. And here's where that metabolic storm comes from. It's inflammation, and it has to do usually with prediabetes. So again, we actually get labs. We go over them in the webinar, and then you can start finding out how you can prevent that heart attack others said that you couldn't even predict. We can show you how. Thanks.